Hey guys, I know it's been a while since my last fan fiction video, last one being on August last year. Hope you enjoy this one. Let's get into it. I'm going to be reading Don't Leave Me, a product of the Cracktoberfest 2018 from the Warcraft Held. In a secluded corner of the underbelly. So can you tell if he's alive, or rather, where Magnus is? Either way, Maleficent trails off, both in anticipation, because she knows the pair before her are too far beyond Buzz to care. The drunk druid leans, or perhaps unintentionally tips forward over the strange assortment both Maleficent and this apparent Draenei soulbinder would maybe a diviner have put together, by the latter's instructions. She pulls a leaf from her hair and adds it to contribute. She'd grown that one more recently. I'm getting a read here. Oh, there it goes, right to the mark. The soulbinder slurred, hard to understand with the alcohol making her accent even thicker. But Maleficent gets the gist of what she says. Ha! We'll see how you like that, Millhouse. Who are we trying to reach again? The Draenei attempts to whisper to the Night Elf woman attached to her arm as they leave. She half shrugs in response, giggle bubbling from her lips. Meanwhile, Leisure Domain Lounge. Oh yeah, alright baby, hit me with another. No gnome should be able to drink this much, the bartender thinks as he pours yet another shot. He'll cut him off for the next one, of course. It's not like he's a real bartender anyway, though maybe he'd been asking for it, dressing up as one for the party. Ah well, he got front row seats to the show of all those heroes letting loose, and other shady characters taking advantage of the night for free booze. Not to mention said gnome with the drinking habits of a dwarf getting knocked over by a... Huh? If someone's over there using some kind of illusion, they better know potions, spells, and other magic items don't count for the costume contest. Whoa-oh, hello there, sweet cheeks. What dropped you in here? Not that I'm complaining. Millhouse deliberately stepped past the shattered remains of the glass he dropped to get a better look at the angel that seemingly fell for him. A night elf, huh? And horns to boot, that's not too common. He's pretty sure. The name's Millhouse. If I can get your... I am Ysera. How did you bring me here, Millhouse, back to the world of the waking? She'd knelt down to speak to him, but living or spirit, it seemed the dragon's voice effortlessly boomed, yet the blaring music must have drowned it out enough, as no nearby parchers looked their way. It took him a second, but oh, had he heard that name before? Grabbing her hand and tugging her along, her thankfully ever graceful and not losing her footing despite the imbalance the height difference caused. He led her outside, both for the fresh air and moderate privacy. The Ysera, huh? She looked up at the moon, the white lady as soon as it come into view. Only meeting his eye again when he spoke. Much as I hate to say it, I don't know what you mean by bring you here. I'd just been enjoying another night of hallows and festivities. She frowned, and he hurried to save. I'm happy to show you around the city, of course, free of charge. She cast him a considering look, the still-present frown turning contemplative. If not you, then who? She asked, ignoring his generous offer. I was brought here. I can feel the tether connecting me to you. It feels weak, easily broken, I'm sure. I don't think this should be ignored. Hallow's End, you say? Surely not a coincidence. With the strong ties to Undeath, yet... Why me? And you? What purpose does this serve? Millhouse blinked. Maybe it was an accident. He leaned back against the wall of the inn, watching as she pursed her lips in farther thought. I, for one, say we make the most of it. Ysera silently raised an eyebrow at him. You said you're stuck with me, huh? Yeah? So let's go have fun. It's Hallow's End, with parties, costumes, and candy galore. Say, you ever had a... G-N-E-R-D? In hindsight, it occurs to me that offering candy to a ghost doesn't quite make sense, but let it be known that I tried. Maybe a mask is more your style. Ysera smiled faintly to herself as he rummaged in a loot-filled pumpkin, muttering about the various types within. She didn't yet want to ruin his fun by reminding him of the unlikelihood of her being able to interact with a mask where the candy failed. Taking what joy she could while here. She couldn't help but snort at the way he flung one mask, a blur of pink streaking by. Aha! He spun, presenting to her a female tauren mask. Ahoy yourself. Don't go throwing things in the inn. Not while I'm looking after it. The temp innkeeper chastised him with a glower before retrieving the discarded mask. Now take your treats before I give you a trick. Oh, I can show you. Hey! Not feeling inclined to bother the human any longer, nor worrying over courtesy such as apologizing. Ysera grabbed Milhouse's shoulder before he could escalate matters, mask still in hand and candies threatening to pour out of his pockets. The temp keeper blinked after him stumbling out. He did smell of alcohol, she muttered to herself. Darn parchers. Please don't go starting fights. I think there's plenty of that without help right now, Ysera said lowly as he pulled him around the building to the Adventide. It was quiet out. One could ignore the raucous music and cheering emanating from the Legerdemain lounge. I wasn't going to do anything nasty, just a little, temporary change of view, maybe, he said, smirk none too reassuring. She gives people a place to sleep, and I can respect that, Milhouse snorted at her. So this mask, you think that'll work out better than the candy? He shuffled his feet under the gaze. I figured the problem was that it's food, right? You don't need that, but a mask is purely cosmetic. And vanity is important, no matter who you are. He nodded to himself as if stating a fact of life. The problem was that I couldn't even pick it up. In this plane, I may be. But I belong fully to the Emerald Dream. I am no longer of this world, Milhouse. It stung her a bit to say, but she'd have to accept her fate. It was not as though the Dream were a bad place to be, by her standards, even eternally. Especially so as pity, however, she would not accept. But I was able to hold your hand earlier, and you grabbed my shoulder too, and you're— Oh! He looked down to where her feet were very much not touching the ground. You're floating. Alright, well that doesn't explain the other stuff. Only being able to physically interact with you, I would assume, has nothing to do with what brought me to you in the first place. She paused briefly, before sighing and getting back to the issue. No point in delaying it. She'd had her fun running around. Think I know of many who would wish my return, but none that would have any reason to send me to a specific person, and certainly not a mage. What of you? He stroked his beard. I do have a few enemies, I suppose. Who doesn't these days? But sending a nice ghost of a green dragon doesn't make much sense. Unless I was right and it was a mistake. That's quite the mistake to make, regardless of which one of us was the intentional target. Who? Milhouse, Jeremis Milhouse, where is he? Maleficent got louder as she seemingly approached from nowhere, causing Milhouse to jump. Ysera pursed her lips, curious from the newcomer. That's still not my middle name, Milhouse cried indignantly. Maleficent stomped closer to Milhouse, poking him in the chest. I don't care, where is he? He tried leaning away, only avoiding tipping over by Ysera's hands going to his back to catch him. Who? What are you talking about? What are you doing here? She poked him again harder. You know who, Milhouse, your father. What did you do with him? Nothing. You know I haven't seen him in years. Why would he be here? He shot a quick glance up to Ysera, who had the audacity to look almost amused by the situation. Wait, oh no. Millie wouldn't go that far, would she? He wasn't kidding anyone. Of course she would, but to fail? That's not like her. So what gives? She also hadn't even acknowledged the dragon in the room. But now that they thought about it, no one they'd come across had, so Millicent didn't know Ysera was here? Ooh. She was also still yelling at him. She'd gotten real pitchy, too. Four of my revenge. Four? Oh, probably stage four, the usual drama. That's nice, Millie, but I think I need to go now. I have a bit of a ghost problem, you see. Very urgent. Don't Millie me. You're not going anywhere. She pulled out a very distressing-looking device that crackled with energy, expecting was meant to incapacitate him in some way. The hand on his back grips his robes. Not today! Of all the horrors Maleficent had intended to inflict upon Milhouse today, seeing him get launched into the air at high speeds wasn't to happen for another 8 stages. Not to mention how he didn't specialize in that sort of magic, she thought. And she was certain it wasn't her device. Still, with nothing to be done of it, the sight of him ascending rapidly and the sound of his undignified scream were pretty satisfying, even though this did put her behind schedule, which, if he'd not seen Magnus anywhere, she already was.
Could a guy get a little more warning next time? Milhouse shouted over the wind, threatening to knock him out of the sky.
How the landing on her back hadn't broken any of his bones, he didn't know, and he feared the idea that she'd done this enough to know how to do it without hurting the 2B passenger. but it was pretty cool. Apologies. I figured it was to remove you from the danger, or ask permission and see what exactly that thing would do.
You do not sound very sorry, he mumbled.
And you do not seem as upset as you suggest. She turned her head slightly to show him her toothy, fangy grin, unbothered by the trees passing just below as they made their way into Valshara, which should probably concern him, but she's already doing a twist in the air before he could respond.
So where are we headed? He asked, once she rightened herself.
She hummed low and deep in her dragon form. Despite Dalaran being your home city, as you're not safe there, I figured I'd bring you somewhere you're not likely to be looked for. The trees are hardly your element, are they?
I am pretty hardy. I can adapt to wherever I go, thank you.
He puffed out his chest. Her laugh was rumbling, which once probably would have shaken the trees beneath him, instead only reaching him. Eventually, a realization hit him. As they flew around the forest, she was enjoying the night air and moonlit forest, which was an unexpectedly sweet understanding to come to, but it made sense to him.
Have you missed this? He asked, unsure if it really was his place to.
Another hum. Despite existing in the dream so long, it seems that upon being awakened, I did become rather attached to this world, and the people of it. Again, really. Still, I can rest at ease knowing the nightmare will not consume it. The dream is my home. I will be happy to return. I'm simply enjoying this fight as the opportunity presented itself. Milhouse made to pull candy out of his pocket, looking at one of the prizes in his hand.
You did say the tether was easily broken, didn't you?
Correct. Brittle, almost. Why do you ask? He carefully held up a leaf as she slowed down to land away from any towns. In the shadows provided, a faint glow could be seen coming from it. She leaned in to see it upon transforming back into her mortal appearance. That would explain the weakness, even now. You see, the magic is slowly burning a leaf away. Days, maybe even weeks for it to finish burning. Unless it were interrupted, broken. Doing his best not to look at it like a ticking time bomb, he gave her a bright smile.
So you'd estimate about the duration of Hallow's End?
Ysera eyed the leaf a moment before nodding. That's about right.
Wanna do more trick-or-treating with me? It takes you all over the place, you know.
Ysera blushed, as she realized she had developed a crush on
Milhouse Manastorm, baby!